of maintenance tunnels underneath a hotel in New England. We are pushing gigantic, odd-shaped road cases trying to find the freight elevator. Cooper is somehow already fully made up and wearing her good little Hamel costume, in which she looks like a medieval nun. We are in a space that, architecturally speaking, is the bottom. It's 1999. We're at a synagogue in suburban Port Washington, Long Island, where Cooper has been hired and is committed to intensify ritual. A crew of us are making the first of the total theater Purimspiel she will mentor for a decade. At the table, holding a serious dramaturgical meeting, are Cooper, George Conoff, one of America's greatest punchmen, that is a player of Punch and Judy, the world's oldest and wickedest puppet in Unleashed. And Ariella Wurzel, a teenager who has walked to the shoal in snow in 5-inch platform sandals. In September 2011, a few of us were visiting Ms. Cooper. She wanted to see us but asked that we cooked. I was in the kitchen preparing kasha. She in the living room on the couch where you can see the fairway sign flash. She smelled the progress and commanded me gently but firmly how to cook through the wall. In 2010, I had the honor of presenting Adrian with the Marsha T. Myers Risk Taker Award for Jewish Racial and Economic Justice. And Myers was a rabbi who resisted the military junta in Argentina in many ways, including lying to prison officials about why they had to physically remove people from jails. He later became the lead rabbi in B'nai Dreshut and was known among the B'nai Mitzvah crew as the Karen Finley of the pulpit. So we sort of, you know, had to evoke Adrian and her connection to this performance artist, political, fearless, creative, fearless individual, not a stretch. But here's an excerpt from the citation followed by Cooper's response. And this citation is written by myself and Jenny Levinson. Adrian Cooper has the voice of a diva and the soul of a Buddhist. She is an interpreter, teacher, and translator of Yiddish song, who for decades has gifted thousands of us with the reawakening of beauty and music. Her service has not just been to generations of students, but to music itself, music that holds the experience of diasporic peoplehood. In her work with Yiddish music, Cooper continues a political vision begun by cultural radicals in Eastern Europe. These activists built institutions like the Yiddish Institute, Yivo, and the Crisis Archive of Ashkenazi Jewry, where Adrian worked throughout the 80s. During her decade of service to the Yivo, Adrian was mentored, among others, by Buddhist survivors who believed in an integrated Jewish culture that lives in the real world and who are committed to the betterment of people in and outside the Jewish community. She's part of the legacy of Jews who rewrote history by building power and institutions grounded in what people were abundantly rich with. Culture. Adrian's movement is a political work of art, in which every fragment of what folk do can be used to chart a new political course. The list of Adrian's organizational commitments are long, so I won't read them. Adrian Cooper is a fearless guide to the cultural commons, who has made sure no one is excluded from this resource, and that no power can silence it. She brings people, ideas, and buildings together to create spaces for unimaginable political joy and artistic joy. She is a forest of Jewish sound, a joyous crowd, a resistance fighter, a lover, I would add, a flirt, a screaming rhetorical street poster, and exotic. For all of this, and for never working from a place of chosenness or nostalgia, but from a place of justice and empathy, and complex Yiddish polyphony, Jacob just received the honor to present the 2010 Rabbi Marshall T. Meyer Risk Taker Award to Adrian Cooper. And then to this, Adrian replied, "Oi!" And then the audience laughed. And then she went on to say, "I grew up in Oakland, California, in Rabbi Harold Schulweis's synagogue. He was our local version of Marshall Meyer, an activist, an agitator, an inspiring intellect. I had a perch on the bima on Yom Kippur, a packed house, when he began his sermon on exploitative Jewish landlords with black tenants in Oakland. The family in the front row in the prime seats, the dollar seats, stood up, led by the landlord father, and headed up the aisles to leave. Rabbi Schulweis told the ushers to sat down.